Hi everyone, this is Carmina. Welcome or welcome back to my channel, Your Stars Aligned. There's also a website with the same name where there are some articles about cards and astrology and occult topics like that I enjoy. Okay, so today we're gonna talk about the correspondence between the pip cards in the playing cards that we use with the cards of truth system as developed by Ernst Wilhelm, and their correspondence to the arcana cards in tarot. So this is going to be a lot of fun, right? I'm also going to mention some numerological connections and connections to astrology. And yeah, as I was saying, I learned this from my teacher Ernst Wilhelm. And if you want to go deeper than this, like, tidbit video, this is like the tapas of the classes. Like, there's so many classes on his website, cardsoftruth.com. You can go there and see lots of example and more in-depth explanations. Okay, so first I want to mention that these days maybe people are more familiar with divination and card reading from tarot decks, right? But what you should know, if you don't already, that the tarot deck was actually developed from like the normal playing card deck, right? So they took that, they added some knights at some point, they interpreted it their own way, they turned the diamonds into coins and the spades into swords. So yeah, so what I like about the playing cards, the pip cards, is that they are like, you know, like, never mind the ponies, but you can see the number and the suit, which is the most important thing. You know, in the tarot decks, even though they're beautifully drawn and they can be helpful sometimes, if that's your cup of tea, they kind of are too subjective. So they stray from the, you know, the original simplicity, right? And they stray one way or the other. But when you see like a simple, for instance, six of clubs, your intuition will tell you which interpretation to pick. But in a tarot card, like, there's a lot of things added by the creator, because like everyone making a tarot deck probably wanted to be like more original and more unique. And I don't know, it got a bit all over the place. But still, as I was saying, like, if you're into tarot, that's really good, and that's using your intuition, so you can use like leaves or rocks to predict. It doesn't matter what you use. I personally had three tarot decks in my life. The first one was the classic Rider-Waite tarot. The second one was the Crowley tarot, which I couldn't really empathize with at all, so I gave it away. It didn't speak to me. And the third one I bought because I really liked the colors, to be honest, and the images, because they remind me of my childhood books of Russian fairy tales. This is a Russian tarot of St. Petersburg, and yeah, it's kind of like this, right? I really like these embellishments, you know. They are really speaking to me like that. So we're just gonna run through the cards and their respective arcana correspondence, right? First, we're gonna talk about the sun and the moon. These correspond to aces, to black and red aces of both suits, of course. Yeah, so each number from 1 to 10 of the pip cards corresponds to arcana cards, and also corresponds to 4 cards in the normal suit, in the normal playing card deck, right? So the first ones that correspond to number 1, and in Tara Nakshatra, if you're familiar with astrology, they correspond to Janma, birth. These are the sun and the moon. and they are the aces, the red and black aces. The aces are, of course, the birth of something new. So something, it can be like a new love, which is like the ace of hearts. It can be the truth, the deepest truth, which is the ace of spades, the most important of the ace cards. And it can be a new idea. If it's an ace of clubs, it can be like a new plot of land, like the ace of diamonds. But anyway, it's something new, it's something a potential that has not yet been explored, right? So the sun and moon. Okay, the next one corresponds to number two, and it's related to coming together or to some accomplishment or of some sort. And in Tara Nakshatra, it corresponds to Sampad. And in the Arcana cards, these are the Emperor, the black twos, and the Empress, the red twos, right? Black and red twos. And these are like moving from that potential that is the ace number one to something that you are having a dialogue with, especially like two of clubs is the card of dialogue, communication, education, like having a dialogue with ideas, right? Having a dialogue with information, which is education. It can also be like two of spades coming together with a remedy that you need, because spades also relate to physical health. It can also relate to coming together as a couple, which is the two of hearts, the most, maybe the most important of the twos. And let's see. Next on number three, the red threes correspond to temperance and the black threes to strength. There's some reflection, but I can't help it. So there's some reflection because of the light outside. And yeah, number three corresponds to, it's a manifestation of the planet Mars in astrology. It corresponds to also the hindrance part of the Tara Nakshatras, and it's something that you fly apart from, right? Because at the two you come together with some accomplishment, but then you have to fly apart and distance yourself from that, right? So that you think more independently. For instance, the three of clubs, which is maybe the most emblematic three, is the card of the independent thinker. The three of diamonds can relate, for instance, to moving away from your land to a new land. And it's also, the threes are the teamwork. And it's actually like the Arcana cards say, strength and temperance. Temperance is the passive three. So like learning to keep it together, you know, because temperance is also like, it takes a lot of strength of character to have temperance. And strength is the active yang strength, right? It's like going out there and doing stuff, because you know, the red suits correspond to the yin energy, the feminine energy, which is more passive. And the black suits, the black cards correspond to the yang energy, which is the more active force, right? So the red suit is more receptive to the world and doesn't really have to go out there. Like, it has to be open to whatever the universe provides. And the black suit is more active and it takes more stress and, yeah, more go-getting. Okay, let's move on to the fourth group of cards, which is, let's see, the High Priestess and the Hierophant. The High Priestess is the corresponds to the red force, and the Hierophant to the black force. So this number four energy corresponds to being secure with something. So after you started something new and you got together with it, and then you flow apart to distance yourself and have your own individual ideas about it. Now you feel secure in that thing, right? Whether it be like your health, your ideas, your emotions, you know, your finances. So these are the number four. Number five. Number five in astrology is a manifestation of the planet Jupiter, and it corresponds to the averted nakshatra, right? So it's something that comes and you avert it, and in the it's something averted. It can look like a catastrophe, but actually it's for your own good, right? It's like the Jupiter, like, is a benefic planet, right? It shows you, like, it's the guru, it's somebody wiser that shows you the big picture. So averted things are things that we think like, oh my god, it's terrible, why did this happen? But when we look back, like, many years or something, we look back on that event, it's like, oh my god, it's so good that that happened. For instance, like, you miss the plane, but then the plane crashes. So you're really pissed off that you missed the plane, but then when you see it crashed, you're like, oh my god, that's number five, Jupiter. That can be Jupiter averted. So in the Arcana cards, it corresponds to the Judgment and the Justice card, right? The Judgment is the black fives, right? The more like the black fives is like the more brutal judgment, right? It corresponds to the five of spades and the five of clubs, and it really pulls you out of something. The red fives are softer, of course, because they correspond to the yin energy, and they're like, they can be either like emotional crises, like the red, the five of hearts. It can be like financial crisis, which is the five of diamonds. Also, five of diamonds can be training, because actually all fives are sort of training, you know. For instance, the five of spades is like rehab, like training of the body and something like that. So let's go to the next group of cards, number six. And the number six is represented in the Arcana by the Devil, the red six. Here they drew like Stalin's picture, which is kind of funny. And the Lovers, you know. So what is six? Six is something, it's the little fulfillment, as my teacher calls it. It's it corresponds to Venus. Right? Venus is one of the Brahmin planets in astrology. The other Brahmin planet is Jupiter. So these two planets are the teachers. As we saw, like, the number five, Jupiter, was teaching us to make a good judgment, right? Sometimes not teaching us, sometimes just making us experience it. And at number six, we get like the worldly fulfillment. And this is like, it can be fulfillment with one's own self, like a full maturation, which is the six of spades, which is a great card to have. Or it can be like a maturation of emotions, like a relationship. The six of hearts can be a marriage card. And yeah, it's like the most you can have with worldly fulfillment, the sixes, right? Then we go to the seven cards, and these correspond to black sevens, the falling tower, and red sevens, death. Seven corresponds as a manifestation of energy, it corresponds to Saturn. So, and it also corresponds to the seventh nakshatra, which is destruction. It's like after you have that small worldly fulfillment, there will come a time when your ideas, if it's like a seven of clubs, or I don't know, your even your relationship, it's a seven of hearts. These things will be destroyed, right? So it's a time where you have to see your limitations, like in this world, like the six can't last forever. But the seven is good because it breaks down the cards before to get you to the higher cards, the eight, the nine, and the ten. So it's like a crisis. It can be like a physical crisis, like illness, like the black seven, especially the seven of spades. It can be a physical illness of the body, or it can even be death sometimes, especially red sevens. But usually it won't be that. It will be just like a crisis where your ideas don't work, where your behaviors don't work, you know, like what is illness? Something that's related to Saturn. It's like your body doesn't work anymore because of your habits, you know. So a crisis of destruction that like takes your focus to where it needs to be, right? It makes you see things realistically. It makes you realize your limits. So it's a very important card. Now let's go to number eight. Can you guess what the eights are connected with in the arcana? Well, the black eights are connected to the chariot. You know, the chariot, which is like a journey. It can be a more of an inward journey, like the black eights, you know, the especially the eight of spades is like a very introspection oriented card, right? Or it can be even like air travel, which is the eight of clubs. And the red eights are connected to the hanged man. That's like this like being suspended and really feeling in that suspended state. You really go inwards and you fulfill yourself. You don't look for external validation anymore, you know. And the eight corresponds rightfully to Rahu, to the north node in astrology, and it corresponds to the Tara Nakshatra, which it translates as friendship, right? So although, I mean, it can be a difficult card because, like, especially the the black ones, like the black eight, especially if it's reversed, it can show like a coma or imprisonment or like a state where you feel really stuck and frustrated. It really is a very like, I don't want to say spiritual, but advanced stage, right? Where you really let go of the worldly things. Like after you had the fulfillment, then your ideas get destroyed, then you go to the eight to really self-validation. And then you get to the nine. The ninth group of cards. And the number nine is a manifestation of Ketu, and in the Tara Nakshatras, it corresponds to divine friendship, right? So it's like really okay. They correspond in the Arcana cards to the Hermit, the black nines, and to the Fool, the red nines. The Fool. So this is really the last step, sort of, because the Hermit is someone who like renounces the world. It's the black nines. It's like the active force. So it's like someone are really isolated, and really at the number eight were like doing something for really not looking for validation. But at number nine, it's really, it goes beyond that, since it's divine friendship, right? You see the divinity in everything, you see God in everything, and you're really a really good card if it comes at in the right place and at the right time, you know. And the Fool is, it corresponds to the nine of hearts and the nine of diamonds. In the nine of hearts is like You have to be like a channel for abundance in the world, you know? It's like a very charity oriented card. And the Nine of Hearts is like you have to love everything good and like things that validate you and don't validate you, and love the world as what it is with its ugly parts as well, because you realize that everything is actually God. So that's a Nine of Hearts. That's a good Nine of Hearts, not a reverse Nine of Hearts that can go like haywire. And then we get to the end of a cycle, the completion of a cycle, which is the red and the black tens, and it corresponds in the arcana to the magician and the wheel of fortune, right? The black tens are the ones that, as the magician, they have to really work hard and pull every trick up their sleeve, right? It's really like you'll have the rewards, you'll have the intellectual rewards, you'll have like the self-development rewards, the physical health or like psychological development, but you really have to work hard. So although it's a good card, like all black cards, like they have to work harder. As for like the red ten, the ten of diamonds, the wheel of fortune is like just everything like comes to you in abundance more easily. For instance, like if you get like a red ten on the ecliptic card, you will get most likely a lot of financial rewards that year. And if you get like the ten of hearts, you'll get popularity and stuff like that. I mean, this is a very broad interpretation, and it has to do with many factors, but you get the point, right? So yeah, the wheel of fortune is like really hitting the jackpot at the casino because after you completed the cycle, you just have to stand there and it comes to you. So it's a really nice card to have. Okay, so I think that's about it. I talked about this long enough. And thank you to my friend Jess, who's also studying the cards and astrology with my teacher Ernst, who said I should do a video on the cards from 1 to 10. And I said, why not? Okay, guys, so as I was saying, if you're interested in reading more about these topics, you can look on my website. There are some articles. Also, there are my services that I provide, like card reading and astrology readings. You can take a look there if you're interested in one of those readings. And yeah, I'll see you later. Bye.